Hi, I'm Sheridan Morris, and my business is Well Said and Associates. I've just been interviewed by Prosperity TV, which has been absolutely fabulous because I've been able to talk about my business and what I contribute to people who want to write a book or having trouble getting content out of their head and heart and onto the page or onto the screen in their website. So we've talked about the sorts of things that people need to consider when they're writing a book, and also, you know, what kind of process it is and what might the costs be, that sort of thing. So it's been really great to have a conversation with you. Prosper's been able to drag some really great information out of me, and I really enjoyed the interview. So I hope you do too.
Welcome to yet another exciting episode of the Online Prosperity Show. And today I've brought you the wordsmith herself, Sheridan. Sheridan, how are you doing, my love?
Very well, thank you. How are you?
Fantastic. Well, obviously, the audience would understand that if you really want to have a business that's profitable and enjoyable, you got to have a message that goes to a particular market, and that market has to be reached by some sort of media. Now, we might use social media, you could use radio, TV, ads, or yell across the town with whatever voice you might have, or you could easily write a book, or you could easily write a speech, or you could easily write a video, or you could easily just write something your consumers can consume at their own time. Now, some of us might have all of that information packed in our heads, in our hearts, but there's no way we can bring it out onto paper so that our consumers can actually catch a glimpse of what we're trying to portray to them. Now, Sheridan, was that even well said?
Yes, it was. And I always call myself a bit of a midwife, really. I help them birth whatever they need to. And sometimes there's a lot of huffing and puffing and screwing up of the face. But, you know, people have so much knowledge inside of them, and they have so much passion, and that's really what I love to work with. I just build the rapport with them, get inside their head, get tune into that passion, and then of course it helps me to write it out. And I always write it out in a draft because they need to go over it. There'll be certain words that I'll put in there that they don't use. I may have misheard something, so we can change paragraphs. But it's also a key point for them to take ownership of what's been created.
Absolutely, because so, it's their name that's going to be either on that piece of paper or on that book. So they better know what's inside of it. Now, obviously, Sheridan, you've probably been doing this for quite a while. How did you get involved, with this writing? And is it something that came out as an accident, or was it a passion, or did you actually, intentionally become a ghostwriter?
I have always been a writer. When I was young, I used to write poetry to express my teenage angst at the world. But in everything that I did in my career, it relied on writing, but I never took it, really took it seriously. I think I did go for an interview to be a journalist, and the person who interviewed me said, "You're too soft, you're too gentle to be a journalist." And I'm kind of glad that they put me off course, because if someone had told me what to write and how to write it, I'd probably get pretty stroppy with them. I do like being freelance and working in that way and working closely with clients. It wasn't until I was in my 40s that I actually had a time when I was quite burnt out from a job that I was doing. I walked away from it, and someone asked me that special question: what is it you do and you love doing it, and when you do it, the time just disappears? And I said, "Oh, my writing." So they said, "Well, go and explore it. Go and, find out what you can do, what kind of writer you are." Now, I thought I was a wonderful fictional writer, but when I went to Holmes Glen College of TAFE, I had a teacher there who set me fairly straight that non-fiction was what I was what, you know, best at. I was a bit miffed at first when she told me, but she was quite right. And then I'd written a submission to create something in my local community in Manningham. And I showed that to one of my other teachers. And he said, stop doing it for free. Here's an association that works with a whole lot of not-for-profit organisations. Contact them and you can start working with them. So, you know, I started writing the annual reports and their new newsletters, their appeal letters. I love the way that they use their database. They knew their sponsors and their donors so well. You know, they really do target their market expertly. And then it sort of blossomed from there. But, I mean, I'm talking about 22-odd years ago when, you know, I typed something up and then I'd print it out and then I'd post it and then the client would look at it and then they'd post it back to me and I'd make the changes and then I'd send my invoice by post and then they'd send the check by post and then I'd have to go and wait in line to bank the check. You know, everything was so darn slow. And of course now with this, with the internet, it is just so satisfying. I love it. Instant gratification. And you've just got that really fast interaction with clients.
Absolutely.
That has been an enormous boom to those of us who are content writers.
Absolutely. And now I understand why you are calling yourself a midwife, because it did take almost 9 months for you to get that book around with the whole constant sending in and back.
Yeah, yeah.
But really coming back to that metaphor, a lot of people have, you know, a book, or they have a lot of content inside of them. They have a book in their hearts, or they have a book right at their fingertips, but they haven't got it, as a real product or put it out there. Now, how do you walk through somebody, or what sort of procedure do you take to actually bring the book out of that person? Because it takes a certain level of, you know, questioning to actually bring out the best. Because if they knew those questions, they'll just ask themselves and write that book.
So I start with working on the synopsis. I have a range of questions that I ask them, and I ask them to sit down and you know, put pen to paper to write the synopsis, because it asks the questions about who they're writing to. It requests them to get a final outcome. What's the final outcome that they're aiming for? All of those kind of, you know, questions that really start to put the structure in place. Then there's conversations about how we get to that end and what chapters will there be, what content do they want, what reaction do they want the reader to have. And so it's quite an involved process, and always just getting it out on paper as quickly as we can or onto the computer. And then there's quite an editing process at the end of it. And the main thing that I aim for is for them to get it out first and then come back and we can edit and tidy up. And quite often by the time they've finished the last chapter, they'll go back and write the first one. Rewrite it, because they realize that they've learned so much in the process of writing the other chapters that they can reframe it, they can express it so much better, you know, and go back and rework it. So it is an involved process, and it's, you know, it's, there's soul searching that goes on with it.
Absolutely.
Because yeah, I have to ask them the hard questions.
Great stuff. Great stuff. Okay. So now, Sheridan, you as the ghostwriter, and maybe somebody has some sort of expertise within them, do you have to know a thing or two about that field for you to write, you know, legibly or convincingly enough for the audience, or the business owner or the person who's writing that book per se really needs to have, you know, their hands on to bring out all the value in the book that's been put out?
Yes, they do need to provide me with information. but it's still got to come from their expertise. So they might give me information that I can research generally about that subject, but it's always their expertise in it. So there's a lot of recording interviews with them.
Right.
And if I've misunderstood anything, you know, when we go through the editing and the reworking of the draft, that's when they'll say, oh, no, this should be this way and that way sort of thing. So, yeah, it is an involved process for them. I can't just, you know, grab their head and sit it down and write. But I, you know, I was that gawky kid at school who understood what poetry meant and would go into rave sessions with the teacher, and all the other kids were sitting there going, oh, so boring, you know. Comprehension is very high for me, and it has been with my schooling. So I could always write an essay and make an argument on a particular subject because there's structure in that, and you stick to the structure. So I think that's a skill that I probably underrate, because when they're telling me about it and they're telling me, you know, very passionately about it, I seem to be able to really tap into that. And there's my natural curiosity about it. And I think that helps, because they can get into jargon. They can make assumptions about what people know and understand. And I'm able to ask those questions like, what does that mean? Okay, so what result would that get? And sort of tease it a little bit so that when the reader reads it, they've got the background and the coverage. There's no, you know, sitting there wondering what a particular word means. It's important that the reader feels like they're on board the whole way.
Absolutely. All right. So, I mean, obviously, I think it's actually wiser to have somebody like you on board, because if you cannot understand it, then the target audience may not be able to understand it as well. So, you know, you will be the correct sort of yardstick, you know, to gauge if people are actually going to read this, you know, and, you know, maybe it becomes one of the best sellers. Now, talking about best sellers, is there any other services that you then provide once the book has been written or once the publication has been, put together, maybe the editing, the formatting, or even publishing?
I certainly do the editing. Formatting, I send that to people who've got skills in graphics, because you know, that needs to be just right. The book needs to be print ready. So that's not my expertise, but I have people that I work closely with and I trust. And also with the publishing, same thing. Go to people who do that, who have that passion and have the skills and facilities on hand. My job is to know who they are and give some recommendations if I can. And if I can't, to research it, to find the best way through. And I think people are getting wiser about publishing, and there are a lot more options open with printing being, you're able to get short print runs printed, and, you know, you don't have to go into full production of thousands of books. I co-authored a book on PMS and menopause with a psychologist, Lynn Chand, way back at the beginning of time in my business. And, of course, we did the traditional buy 2,000 copies. And then, you know, we've still got some hanging around. People don't get stuck with that now. They can actually go and it's good for them to negotiate with the printer to find just the right fit for them. So, yeah, I certainly help where I can, but my expertise is with the content.
Absolutely. Great stuff. So we've figured out, obviously, you know your style of writing. We've figured out the other services that you can, put out there. What other things should people know when it comes to, birthing that book? You know, some people might just think, yeah, I've got a book idea, but, you know, have you got any sort of stuff that people really, really need to know to get started, so that it's not too much back and forth with you, so that when they come through, they come already prepared?
Well, I think the synopsis of the book is where we start. If someone can't articulate in a page or a couple of pages what the book is about, then it's going to be difficult for them to really start to generate the content for the rest of it. You know, because a lot of people can write, they can write reams and reams of pages, but it hasn't got structure, it doesn't lead the reader through the process, it doesn't, you know, have a call to action in it that's effective. So I love creativity, I love the creativity of writing, but I particularly like the structure as well. And where that came out most for me was when I started to explore comedy. Comedy has the most amazing structures and formulas. And you, once you learn those, you can start to use them to start to create your own presentations, you know, to add a bit of humour. You start to know what personality would fit with a particular form of comedy. And then, of course, if I'm writing a speech for a client, or I'm helping them with their business collateral, and they have that kind of sense of humour, that needs to be in the speech and in their business collateral as well. Because then people are starting to know them. People will always buy from people. You've heard that 1,000 times over.
Absolutely.
And it's true. It's very true. And that's often the point of difference that somebody has from somebody else.
Absolutely. Talking about people buying from those that they know, like, and trust. Somebody in the audience who's watching this right now, Sheridan, is probably ready to purchase from you. But obviously, maybe their biggest question would be the way that you charge. Do you charge per page, per word, or do you charge per book, or do you charge per hour? How do your sort of services work out?
I find it's best to work on a project basis. Then they know what their budget is, and we do progress payments throughout the time. So that's a lot easier for people. And it's also, we're reaching certain key,
milestones.
Milestones along the way. And that saves me writing a whole book and then, you know, waiting for payment afterwards. It works for me and it works for them. It's that process of building the trust as we go along. But I think in just about everything that I do, there are a couple of things where I do per page or per hour, but generally I do it as a project basis, especially when I'm working with small to medium enterprises. They have a budget. And so I say, okay, this is what it's going to be to write the content for your website or write your brochure. And we do progress payments through it. It works for their budget and it works for mine as well. And then they're not left with like an endless bill. You know, they might think if it's per hour, they don't know how many hours it's going to be.
Absolutely.
And if I'm going to provide it on a project basis, then it's up to me to structure it so that we keep moving through that process as quickly as we can, as efficiently as we can.
Absolutely. I've also heard that once somebody has put out a book there, it's like a tattoo. They're going to need one more and another and another and another. How do you work with people that then want to engage you for like a series of books that they might want to put out there?
Well, I think I'd do the same thing. I just, we'd work out the project, and there may be some content that's going to be in everyone, say the background of the writer or, their personal story. If that's added in, I'd just negotiate with the client. It's easier to do it that way because I'm gauging how much input I have, and they're sort of working out their commitment in a lot of ways. Because writing a book takes time, and it is a journey that we go through with it. So it's not just something that you do over a weekend. I know some programs start you with those sorts of things, but really to get right down into a book, it takes a process. So, yeah.
Absolutely. Well, Sheridan, you have been very, very wonderful today with your depth of knowledge, expertise, and just your whole storytelling, capabilities there. Now, if somebody is sitting there and they're probably, looking at 2018 as the year that the book is going to come out, what's the best way that somebody can get a hold of you there, Sheridan?
Oh, well, they can email me, Sheridan@wellsaid.com.au. And they can give me a call on 0419 547 810.
Okay, 0419 547 810.
And of course, I'm on Facebook, so they can use Messenger with me, text, whatever.
Absolutely.
Well, there are so many options now these days. It's great.
Great stuff. I was calculating the other day, Sheridan, you'd be surprised. There's 34 ways that my wife can get a hold of me. So, yeah, so every time she tweets me, I messenger her back, and then she WhatsApps me, and then I write it on her wall. So that's fun too. Great stuff. Well, thank you so much there, Sheridan, for your time, obviously, your expertise, and just really drawing back the curtain, because some people don't quite realize that the process either is that extensive, but it's still doable. And then they, stay back, with the knowledge that they have. I remember, I don't know if you have heard of a motivational speaker called Les Brown, and he's got a famous statement that he says, the wealthiest place in the world is the graveyard. A lot of people die with books inside of them, speeches inside of them, movies that nobody ever heard. So there's people like Sheridan that can absolutely help you give birth to that book, and so you can actually leave and also contribute your knowledge to future generations and create a legacy of your own. Now, Sheridan, I hope what we've created here is going to help birth quite a lot of books in and around, and I sincerely hope that our audience is going to be clamming all over your door and all those contact details that you gave us so that they can actually put out content out there. Thank you so much for your time and compliments of the season.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and the same to you.
Great stuff.